Hi everybody, I'm Professor Adam Teman of the EnICS Labs at Bar-Ilan University. And today, we're going to be discussing logic simulation and demonstrating it with Cadence Xcelium. So, as a short introduction, in the lecture we learned about writing RTL. We learned about the basic syntax of Verilog, we learned about constructs that are used, we learned about writing synthesizable RTL, and we discussed recommended coding style. We will now see how to run a logic simulation that performs a direct test. So we're going to write a test bench that drives stimuli for our block. We're going to instantiate the device under test, which is the RTL block within the test bench. We're going to run the simulation and look at those signal waveforms. And we're going to look at some tickle commands that enable us to automate this process through a script. So what is Cadence Xcelium? Xcelium is Cadence's tool for logic simulation and verification. It encompasses several tools in one combined executable that is called XRun. Actually, inside the XRun executable, there are several tools that are run, such as ncverilog, ncelaborate, and others. But nowadays, they're all run inside one tool that's called XRun. Previous versions were called iRun because the tool was called incisive. Nowadays, it's called Xcelium, and the executable is XRun. So what is inside XRun? Well, it can do compilation, compiling the hardware description language code that's written in Verilog, System Verilog, VHDL, maybe some others. It can do elaboration, which actually takes the read-in Verilog and compiles it into an internal database structure, which then can be run and looked upon. It simulates it, so it simulates the behavior of the test bench and the device under test. And it allows debugging with signals on waveforms and additional debugging tools. When we run XRun, some important files are created, which include the xrun.log file. And this is a log file that contains all the errors and warnings. So if something doesn't work, we look through this log file and try to figure out what it is. There's an xrun.history file, which is the last command line used to invoke Xcelium. And this is sometimes very worthwhile to either rerun the previous simulation or to copy the command that was run and keep it in a script. And there's a worklib library, which is a scratch directory that has the compiled files inside. And there are some others. So how do we run Xcelium? Well, it's very simple with the xrun command. It actually does it all. So if I write xrun myfile.v, it's going to run xrun on my file. But that is just the beginning of a big can of worms because it has a lot of options. So some of the control options we can see here. So first of all, the file name .v, whatever that is, that's just a Verilog file, or we actually put a long list of Verilog or VHDL or System Verilog files after the command line as arguments to XRun what it's going to run on. We can use the minus debug flag, or it used to be minus access plus RW, which is still supported, which provides us access to simulation objects. So if we want to go and do things like look at waveforms and stuff, we have to have this minus debug flag. Minus GUI will open the GUI of SimVision, which is one of the tools, the tool that allows us to view waveforms and other types of stuff. So minus GUI will open the graphical user interface. Minus Y will compile RTL files in the directory that we put here. Minus V specifies the name of the library to use. Clean will delete all kinds of previous compilations. Minus Compile just compiles the code. Minus Elaborate just elaborates the code but does not simulate. What the really useful ones are minus F, which is a file of arguments for XRun to run. We'll see how that is used. Or minus Input will actually pass a tickle file to run after elaboration. So what are some other flags that we commonly use? So minus SV, it means it accepts System Verilog code, and that's an important thing to do often. Minus V93 accepts VHDL 93 updates. Minus debug saves database info display for displaying waveforms and debugging. Minus GUI, as we said, opens up the UI. Minus timescale adds a default timescale directive for Verilog modules that are missing them. Minus define defines a value to send to the Verilog code. And minus specify disregards any annotated delays, something that we should not use with back annotation. But we'll be discussing these things later. These are just some of the flags that we often add when we're running XRun. So these options are kind of hard to write every time we write out the actual command. So we can provide some sort of a file that has these written down. And I put that under the scripts folder in an XRun options file. And we have one for RTL. We have one for gate level. We have one for back annotation. So we're going to look at those in a little bit. Going to what we're going to actually do, I will remind you of the counter example that we had in class. So it was a 4-bit counter, and it received the following inputs. It received clock, which was the system clock. Reset N was an active low reset. Act is an activate signal. Up, down, N is to count up if it's a 1 or to count down if it's a 0. And it has two outputs, count, which is the current counted value, and overflow in case it overflows. So our header of our Verilog file was going to be this SM. It gets as a parameter something called counter width, which defaults to 4. And it gets clock, reset, act, up, down, and it gets the output has counter width minus 1 to 0, which is called count. And it has overflow, which is a single bit output. We also defined several local parameters, which are for encoding our states, and those are idle, count up, count down, and overflow, and this was the state machine that we implemented inside our Verilog code. So let's go ahead and look at our test bench. So our test bench, which we called state machine test bench, SMTB, it has a parameter for the width of the counter, which is 5, and we're going to pass that into our DOT just to demonstrate how we can pass a parameter to a DOT. We're going to have registers, which are going to be the inputs to our design. So clock, reset, N, act, and up, down, N. And they're the same names as the interface that we have to our DUT, just conveniently. We have the counter wire is going to be width minus 1 to 0. And we're going to have a single bit for overflow. Then we have our initialization stage, which is how we begin. So at the beginning, clock is going to be held high and reset is going to be held low. So reset, since it's a low reset, it's going to be activated when we start our test bench. Act is going to be at 0, activate is going to be at 0, and up, down, enter is going to be at 1. We also put in this monitor command, which is going to print out all kinds of things every time something changes. And after 100 time steps, 100 nanoseconds, we're going to release the reset by raising it to 1. Okay, we have a clock, which is going to toggle every 5 nanoseconds, so we have a 10 nanosecond period. And then we have our stimuli. So we released reset at after 100 nanoseconds, and we initial begin again here. So after 100 nanoseconds, we're also going to raise activate. So right when reset is released, we're going to start counting, and we're going to start counting up. So that's going to run for 100 cycles. We're going to run up to 1,000. So obviously, at some point, we're probably going to hit an overflow. Okay, at time 1,000, what we're going to do is then reset again and take activate down low. So that's going to reset our whole state machine. We're going to wait 10 more clock cycles and release the reset, and then we start counting up again. Okay, so we count up to 4, then count down to overflow. So after 100 nanoseconds, we're going to activate the counter, so it's going to start counting up. And it's counting up because we're putting up, down, N at 1. And 4 cycles later, we're going to change up, down to 0. So it's going to start counting down until it hits an overflow. So that's our simple test bench. Now let's go and see this in action. Okay, so we open up our workspace in the VS Code Explorer over here. And we go over to source code. Just to remember, we have sm.tb_tb.v. That's this file over here. We have our parameter width is 5. And this is everything we just showed. Okay, and we have under RTL, we have sm.v. And so that is what we have over here. And what I can do is go over to the terminal and write xrun. And take the test bench. So under source code, test bench, sm.tb, and under source code, RTL, sm.v, and I run those two things, and it's going to compile and elaborate, and then these are those monitors that I stuck there. So I can go through these and see exactly what all the changes were in the signals and look at the monitors that I printed out. However, that's not exactly how it's easy to look at things, because we did not open up the UI and the debug part. I just used a very simple type of initiation of the tool. So what I provided instead of that was actually first of all, a DUT source list, which is over here, which is a file that has the list of actual RTL files and so forth I need. Right now, this is the only thing that is not commented out, and that is pointing to my single Verilog file that I'm going to run. So my DUT file is under here. And under scripts, we have this xrunoptions.rtl file, which has all those options we talked about a minute ago, such as minus SV, minus V93, minus debug, and importantly, minus GUI, so we can open this thing up. Okay, and then what it's going to do is going to bring in minus F, which is a file that's going to have all of the source code that I need. And we saw that under DUT source list, it's actually only pointing to one file right now, but it could potentially be many, many files. And it also points to the main file that I'm going to run, which is sm.tb underscore tb. So I put that at the end. I could have put it inside this DUT source list just for cleanliness. I don't have that. That's not one of my RTL files. It's the test bench. So that's the test bench that I'm going to run. All the rest of the things, we may discuss them later, but right now they're commented out. Okay, so then what I can do is go back to my terminal over here, and I can do xrun minus f dot dot slash scripts xrun options dot rtl. And we run that, and it's going to do the same thing, and then it's going to start the GUI. So the GUI of Xcelium has loaded over here. And what I have is, first of all, the design browser, which is this part, and I have the console. Right now, the console says console SimVision. I have two consoles over here, one for SimVision, which is the waveform, and one for the simulator. And this is the scope of where this is running. If you really go into this, you can figure out how, where to write each type of command and how, or do it from a script. What we have over here is the design browser, and the top level that we have in the simulator is SM underscore TB. So if we click on SM underscore TB, we see the different signals that we discussed a second ago. So we have activate, clock, counter, which is, you see it's 5 bits, right? That's what we passed as a parameter. We can open it up and we can see each bit explicitly. We have overflow, reset, and up, down. Width is something that we don't much care about. That's kind of the just a constant value. But the other ones, we probably want to output them on a waveform and see what they are. So I'm going to click on all of them, right click, and do send to waveform window. And now in my waveform window, I have the different signals, and I can change the order, like put clock at the beginning, for example, and maybe put count and overflow at the bottom, because they are kind of like our outputs. And so we have all of our signals. We don't see any waveforms over here because we haven't simulated it currently. Okay, we can also go and look what's inside. We have instantiated inside our DUT, that's our state machine, and we can see different things, what the different values of the internal signals are over here. These are the inputs and outputs, and these are the internal state of the of this whole thing. So counter width, you see we passed it over as 5. And we can look at different things inside, like to see what the state is or whatever. Going back to the signals, however, for example, we have count, and it's going to show us in hexa what the value is, but maybe I want to look at that actually in decimal. So I can go right-click, radix mnemonic, and change that to a decimal type of a state, and it will be easier maybe for the human eye to look at. Okay, so then I can go back into my Xcelium window, and I can do something like run 1500, and it will run 1500 steps. I see that that I got these monitors out here that we saw before, but I can also look at what's going on in my window over here. So if I go over onto this window, and because I made it kind of small, you don't see all the icons, but over here I have this equals icon, and that will show me the entire run. And what can I, and then I can use my, for example, my left click to drag over here and zoom in. So I'm going to zoom in on a certain area over here, which shows me that I have, you know, the first 100 nanoseconds, second 100 nanoseconds, and so forth. And exactly as we asked it to, at 100 nanoseconds, my reset was released. So you see reset was low and it was released over here. And activate goes from 0 to 1. Okay. And then pretty much after that, with there are two cycles that go by because of the state machine, and then the counter changes over here to 1, then 2, then 3, then 4, then 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. We should have 32 bits total in the counter. So you see when we reach 31, the next one is an overflow, and the overflow signal goes up and everything gets stuck there. It doesn't continue counting, and we're in that state until we go way, way, way ahead to the time of 1,100 picoseconds, when we actually reset the machine by pulling down the reset. Once we pull down the reset, overflow goes down, counter is at zero, and now reset stayed low for 100 nanoseconds. Okay, after 100 nanoseconds, we released reset. Soon after that, we released activate over here. And with releasing activate, up, down, as you can see, it was at one. And then we see we started counting up. We started counting up until 40 nanoseconds later, we pulled up, down, low. The counter was able to count those four time steps, and then it started counting down. So as you can see, count down until, again, it reached zero. It tried to count down further than that, and that was an overflow, and so the overflow went up. So we see we had our entire run over here in the simulation. So now I had to do quite a few things in order to set up the window like I wanted to see it, with all the mnemonics and so forth. What I can nicely do is I can save a command script to run that next time. So I'll go up to here over File, and then I'll go to Save Command Script. It gives me the possibility of putting in a name. It's called restore.tickle. Okay, and it tells me xrun minus f dot dot scripts xrun options rtl minus input restore will be able to reload that at that point. So I'm going to click OK. Okay. And if I go back to my thing over here, now inside my workspace, I will have a file called restore.tickle. And if I look through, there's a lot of stuff going on in here. But in the end, what it does, it opens up a database and probes things into it. So that means it's going to debug all of the signals that are inside. And then it runs the simvision command, which is the kind of the simulator, one of the tools that runs under Xrun, minus input restore tickle.svcf. So we see that there's another file here called svcf, right? And this is a command script, which is also going to do a whole bunch of stuff. But basically, it's it has inside it all kinds of different things here that we set. So it tells it to open up the waveform window, and which signals to add to the waveform window, which are clock, activate, all these guys, right? It tells us what zoom to put in the waveform window in here, what size the waveform window should be, and so forth. So it tells us a lot of things. Okay, and now what we're going to do is xrun minus f dot dot slash xrun scripts xrun options dot rtl minus input, and we said we're going to input restore dot tickle, which is sitting here inside the workspace. So I'm going to click enter, and it's going to run it. Okay, and it's still working, and lo and behold, you see it even moved the windows to the way I was before and showed us exactly the zoom that we were before. It has the decimal mnemonics here, the order that we set up these things, and so forth. So it's really worth doing this save command script, and then using, you know, you don't have to keep the whole script, but you can go in and see what the actual tickle commands that moved things around and changed things the way we wanted, and then you can source it with this minus input after you run your script. So that is basically how we run a simulation and use Xcelium and SimVision to look at the different waveforms and so forth. There are a lot things that you can do here. Use the user manuals, just play around with the menus. I don't know, do things like zooming in and zooming out and so forth. And you know, you'll find a lot of stuff again, but this is just a brief of how to get started with these things. And I think you can figure out the rest.